It's time for Declare Your Independence with Ernest Hancock.
It just ain't the same. Always you change. New days are strange. Is the world insane? If love and peace is so strong, why are the pieces of love that don't belong? Nations dropping bombs. Chemical gases filling lungs of little ones with ongoing suffering. As the youth are young, so ask yourself, is the loving really gone? So I could ask myself, really, what is going wrong in this world that we living in? People keep on giving in, making wrong decisions, only visions of them dividends. Not respecting each other, denying thy brother. A war's going on, but the reason's undercover. The truth is kept secret, it's swept under the rug. If you never know truth, then you never know love. What's the love, y'all? Come on.
I don't know.
What's the truth, y'all? Come on.
I don't know.
What's the love, y'all?
People killing, people dying, children hurting, and crying. Can you practice what you preach?
Oh man, good words, good words. Black Eyed Peas. This is where is the love? The first thing you gotta do is find out, you know, where's all the hate? And where is it really coming from? It's always we are aggressively bombing the living snot out of so many people going on in Libya right now in support of many other regimes around the world that are dictators, and we're supposed to be this bastion of freedom kind of thing. We got Raed Jarrar is author and blogger and has a book out that I'm sure is, I have not read the book, but you know, we kind of lived it along with you for a couple of years there, right? I remember having you on while the bombs were falling in Baghdad and your family was in danger. And now I see that after the fall of Baghdad, you went on to become part of the door-to-door census, you know, of people. Tell me about that experience and why you did that and who were you working for?
After the fall of Baghdad, there was a consensus among U.S. mainstream media that the war was civilian friendly, and that only the bad guys were killed by the smart bombs, and civilians were spared. And my own experience was very different. My neighborhood was bombed in the first week of April, and my family and I had to run away from our neighborhood. We decided to, you know, pack two bags and jump in our cars and just drive out of the neighborhood. All of this happened in less than 5 minutes. After us, of course, you know, planning to stay at the house for months and digging a well in our backyard and, you know, buying enough food that will be enough for us for, you know, a year or so, and a generator and all of these things. We ran away because our neighborhood was bombed. And I saw dozens of civilians from my neighborhood killed and injured and being moved by ambulances. And after that, I saw more and more civilians killed in the street. And so I thought that this would be an important contribution that I can make to the debate. If I can work on a civilian casualty survey, on the one hand, to remember all of these victims, all of the Iraqis who were killed for no reason during the 2003 bombing, and for the other hand, to actually debunk the myth that these smart bombs only killed bad guys, and show that, you know, there is no such a thing as a smart bomb. A bomb is a bomb. It kills everyone that is around it when it explodes. So I started working first by myself. Then I met an American woman, a young American woman, who did similar work of documenting civilian casualties stories, writing profiles of civilian casualties in Afghanistan. Her name was Marla Rozica. And I say her name was, not is, because unfortunately, this was the biggest irony of our survey. She herself was killed in Iraq in 2004, and we ended up adding her name to the same statistics and numbers that we were adding other people's names on. It was a very tragic story, and it showed that you know, this war and the collapse of security does not spare anyone, whether they were Iraqis or Americans. Everyone is in danger. But that civilian casualty survey results are all online. Your viewers and the audience can actually view it if they go to civilians.info. That's the website. So it's www.civilians.info.
Is that plural or singular? Is it civilians or civilian?
Yeah, it's a plural. Civilians. Okay. There is an S at the end.
Okay. Civilians.
Dot info.
Civilians.info. I'm very interested in your story, and I'm sure we'll have you back. And I remember also you came to great prominence in 06 before the publication of your book, that you were at JFK Airport wearing a shirt that just simply said, "We will not be silent," in English and Arabic. And JetBlue, they pulled you aside and, "Oh, heck no. You're looking a little too brown to be wearing an Arabic script shirt, so we're going to have to ask you to, do something about it." Give us a 30-second synopsis of that. But the end result was the ACLU filed the lawsuit, and you got a $250,000 settlement. And it was just so, I guess they just picked on the wrong guy. But tell me what happened.
Yeah, I mean, what you described was right. I was stopped at JFK by the TSA and JetBlue security. And they did not let me board on the airplane just because I looked like an Arab and I had a T-shirt with Arabic writing on it. And I told them in the airport that I think this is my constitutional right as a U.S. taxpayer and permanent resident at that time. That was before I became a U.S. citizen. I told them it's my constitutional right to pick the T-shirt that I like. I don't think that the message is offensive or calls for violence or anything. And of course, they did not let me wear it because I looked like an Arab and because they are afraid of the language and afraid of how I look like. So I told them on the airport that I will follow up on this and I will sue them. And I did, actually. I did that directly. I contacted the ACLU and filed a lawsuit against them, which was a very hard process that took 3 years. I think by the end, I did make a very clear point that what happened to me was wrong. It should not have happened to me, and it should not happen to anyone else in the future.
But it does. It happens all the time. You know, this kind of, I'm not sure. I'm glad that you did it, and I'm glad that you prevailed, but I just flew to Philadelphia and back this last weekend, and I'm so tired of, you know, my friend Barry Hess is a libertarian candidate for office a lot, and he has a saying. He goes, you know, I feel like I just got this overwhelming feeling that I'm supposed to turn myself into somebody, but I don't know to who or for what, you know? And that's kind of the feeling that they want to put in. In fact, it's intentional. It's all this PSYOP stuff. But when we come back, I want to talk about the publication of the book, what kind of impact that had, and what the heck are you doing in Washington, D.C.? You know, I'm tired of trying to waste time with these congressmen, and we have other ways of making change. And we're going to talk to Raed Jarrar more about it when we come back.